In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
It's a very great pleasure to be back here with you at St. George's, for the first time for me since March. I know James has done some services. It seems a very long time, and it feels quite strange seeing people in the flesh rather than on Zoom. But I'm delighted that we're able to also broadcast our service to those who are joining us on Zoom and can't be with us in person today. Many of you will be aware that the government only released their advice about mask wearing indoors late last week, and we're still very much digesting it. The latest appears to be that the wearing of masks in churches, while strongly advised, is not yet compulsory. You must, of course, make your own choice on that, given that everybody is reasonably well spread. We begin the service with our act of confession. We now open our hearts to be strengthened by God's mercy. Merciful Lord, you are our hope when we have failed. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Merciful Lord, you give us courage to move forward. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Merciful Lord, you call forth the best in us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May the God of love and power forgive you and free you from your sins, heal and strengthen you by his Spirit, and raise you to new life in Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray. Generous God, you give us gifts and make them grow. Though our faith is small as mustard seed, make it grow to your glory and the flourishing of your kingdom, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Please be seated for our first reading.
The first reading is taken from the first book of Kings. At Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream by night, and God said, "Ask what I should give you." And Solomon said, "You have shown great and steadfast love to your servant, my father David, because he walked before you in faithfulness, in righteousness, and in uprightness of heart towards you. And you have kept for him this great and steadfast love, and have given him a son to sit on his throne today. And now, O Lord my God, you have made your servant king in place of my father David, although I am only a little child. I do not know how to go out or come in. And your servant is in the midst of the people whom you have chosen, a great people, so numerous they cannot be numbered or counted. Give your servant, therefore, an understanding mind to govern your people, able to discern between good and evil. For who can govern this, your great people?" It pleased the Lord that Solomon had asked this. God said to him, "Because you have asked this, and have not asked for yourself long life or riches or for the life of your enemies, but have asked for yourself understanding to discern what is right, I now do according to your word. Indeed, I give you a wise and discerning mind. No one like you has been before you, and no one like you shall arise after you. For the wisdom that guides us."
Praise Alleluia, alleluia. I am the light of the world, says the Lord. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness. Alleluia. The Lord be with you.
And with you.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus put before them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed that someone took and sowed in his field. It is the smallest of all the seeds, but when it has grown, it is the greatest of shrubs and becomes a tree, so that the birds of the air come and make nests in its branches. He told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like yeast that a woman took and mixed in with 3 measures of flour until all of it was leavened. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which someone found and hid. Then in his joy he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls. On finding one pearl of great value, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was thrown into the sea and caught fish of every kind. When it was full, they drew it ashore, sat down and put the good into baskets, but threw out the bad. So it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come out and separate the evil from the righteous and throw them into the furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Have you understood all this? They answered, yes. And he said to them, therefore every scribe who has been trained for the kingdom of heaven is like the master of a household who brings out his treasure what is old and what is new. This is the gospel of the Lord. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our truth and our redeemer. Amen. I can imagine the scene that the gospel portrays. And Jesus at the very end saying, and you've understood all of this. And the disciples saying, of course we understand all of this, knowing full well that they hadn't a clue what Jesus was talking about. And I think that's quite right. I suspect that even today we haven't got much of a clue what Jesus is talking about in this seemingly random selection of parables. But I think Jesus is attempting to describe the indescribable. You cannot describe heaven and what heaven will be like. You can only give sort of snapshot images, none of which build up an accurate picture. If it's quite neatly with our Old Testament reading from Kings, because it begins with Solomon in a dream. And in some ways, the parables in the Gospels are as unconnected as dreams often are. If you're anything like me, your dreams will switch from one thing to another quite randomly, but exceptionally vividly. And dreams were where people in the ancient world thought that one connected most closely with God, because that is where truths were really to be found. Because Solomon is dreaming about what might be. What sort of a king might he be? As I was reading it, I was taken back to our evening prayer of a couple of weeks ago, when there was another series from the Old Testament of David, who was being hunted by Saul and was in a cave, and he resisted. And it was very much around the art of the possible and the art of the best. David made a decision not to kill Saul at that point, because actually that was not only the right thing to do, but actually bore fruit for David in future years. That sort of moral decision of the best and what we, if the moral decision of whether we should do something because we can do something, is also one that every ruler and every prime minister also faces. Because we can do something, should we do something? And that is contrasted today with Solomon, who has asked not for life, not for wealth, for the life of his enemies, but an understanding to discern what is right. And I wonder what sort of decisions Solomon might have faced, what sort of dreams he had for his nation. As T. Lawrence put it, all men dream, but not equally. Those who dream by night, in the dusty recesses of their minds, wake in the day to find it was vanity. But the dreamers of the day are dangerous men, for they may act their dreams with open eyes to make it possible. What sort of dreams do we hope our rulers have? Do we want them to dream of riches for themselves, for the countries, for the demise of their enemies? Or rather, would we have them like Solomon, to have a dream of wisdom, of fairness, of equality? These are dreams which some have, but others don't. How do we ensure that the dreams of equality, fairness, and justice are ones that actually we can make true, make alive, and make come to pass? Because for each of those, we can dream. And for each of them, it's a little like each of those parables in the New Testament, each one seemingly unconnected to the other, but each giving us a glimpse of what the kingdom of God might actually be. Dreaming of freedom, of equality, of justice, and hope is where we need to be as individuals, as a community, and as a country. Because as the popular saying goes at the moment, Black Lives Matter. And each of our lives matters, because everyone needs to contribute to building a kingdom in which all can flourish, all are worthy, and all are respected. Because the end of our gospel ends with a rather uncomfortable passage. And I'm not entirely certain it means what we ought to think, what a lot of people think it says. It says, the angels will come out and separate the evil from the righteous and throw them into the furnace of fire where there'll be wailing and gnashing of teeth. But it doesn't actually say that it's the bad that will be thrown into the fire. It doesn't specify whether it's the good or the evil, the righteous or the unrighteous. It reminds me of Christmas, where we often have that setting of a refiner's fire, where we all shall be purified. Because none of us are perfect. None of us have ultimate wisdom. And none of us have ultimate truth. We can only see glimpses of it until, at the last, we shall be made perfect. Amen. And so let us stand to declare our faith in God. We believe in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named. We believe in God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with his love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. And so let us pray.
Lord Jesus Christ, we pray for our church and ministerial team, and especially welcome back Father Neil in person. We give thanks for their responses and ongoing inventiveness in the current crisis, for the wonderful range of daily services, coffee and poems, quizzes, general interest groups, and Bible study by video and telephone links. We pray for your help as we continue to experiment with worshipping in a new blended format. And we give thanks for the joy of seeing each other, for live music, although not today, and for worshipping together. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord God Almighty, we pray for the vulnerable, for those still isolating alone, sometimes far from their families. We pray for those exhausted by their demanding jobs, and for those in low-paid jobs with little security. We pray for those who have lost jobs or whose livelihoods are threatened, and for all job hunters. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Help us to continue to keep an eye out for those who are struggling. May we also remember to pray for and support other societies, often overseas, who are facing far greater challenges. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father of all creation, we thank you for the many unexpected benefits of recent times, for families spending time together, for learning new skills, for discovering our city and the countryside, and for the joys of cycling, wild swimming, and dusting down our long-forgotten books. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Merciful God, we continue to pray for the sick and suffering, for all those known to us, and in particular for Harold Carter, Jean Root, Shelley Miller, Amber Sinclair, Maria Cariotti, Pat Turner, and Ray Vondrela. We commend to you, our Father in heaven, all who have died known to us, for Libardo Paternim, and for those whose anniversary of death falls at this time, including John Hill, Robin Whitworth, Dick Stratham, Dorothy Patterson, Walter Reed, Hugh Harding, Scipio Pantaleo, Chloe Fraser, Oliver Campion, Christopher Smale, Isaac Houston, Betsy Ferguson, and Angela Howard Bent. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Please stand for the peace.
Jesus said, "Love one another. As I have loved you, so you are to love one another." The peace of the Lord be always with you.
Amen.
Let us share one another God's peace in a contactless way. Give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. From sunrise to sunset this day is holy, for Christ has risen from the tomb and scattered the darkness of death with light that will not fade. This day the risen Lord walks with your gathered people, unfolds for us your word, and makes himself known in the breaking of the bread. And though the night will overtake this day, you summon us to live in endless light, the never-ceasing Sabbath of the Lord. And so, with choirs of angels and with all the heavenly host, we proclaim your glory and join their unending song of praise. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Lord, you are holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit, and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in the same night that he was betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood, the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup. And we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of the Blessed Virgin Mary, St. George, St. John the Baptist, St. Mary Magdalene, St. James, and all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, for ever and ever. Amen. Amen. As our Saviour Christ has commanded and taught us, so we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. Let us pray. Lord God, whose Son is the true vine and the source of life, ever giving himself that the world may live, may we so receive within ourselves the power of his death and passion, that in his saving cup we may share his glory and be made perfect in his love. For he is alive and reigns now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
And we pray together, Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Please be seated for a minute. Most of the notices, I think, are in the back of your service sheets. The service pattern continues as it has done on Zoom. Monday to Friday, morning prayer at 9:15. On Mondays and Thursdays, evening prayer at 4:30. And on Tuesdays and Fridays, compline at 9:30. Mondays is meditation at 6. And Thursday at 11 is poetry and coffee. Do feel free to join in any or all of those if you so wish. Everybody is very welcome. Can I draw your attention to Margaret's farewell service at 10 on the 27th of September, which is our harvest service. And there's a collection being made for Margaret, and it does say it's Bill James or Janet Lloyd who are taking charge of that. Thank you, Janet. I suspect anything given electronically is preferable to cash donations at the moment. Thank you. And in terms of donations, I need to say an exceptionally big thank you to all of you who have been so wonderfully generous with the lighting appeal at St John's. As you know, we had to raise £10,000 so that we could complete the planned scheme. Thanks to your generosity, we've actually raised £14,000, which together with gift aid takes us well above our target. It means that some of the things we'd said we couldn't do at the moment, we are optimistic that we can do, and so we're hoping for a slightly better scheme than we had originally planned, as we didn't get the money. Thank you for all of your contributions, large and small. They're going to make a real difference to how we can operate in St John's. I think that's all of the notices, unless I'm missing anything obvious.
No 8 a.m. service next Sunday.
Sorry?
No 8 a.m. for August.
Thank you. Yes, no 8 a.m. service from next Sunday, as in August we don't have those services. We're also, as a clergy team, trying to take some rest time over the summer. And therefore we'll be mimicking what some cathedrals do, in that one of us will be sort of in residence each week and we will take the services each week in turn. So Dana was kindly doing all of last week's services. She's now relieved as I'm taking over the services for this week, and then I think next week it's Peter after me. So you'll see each of us in bulk one time. It doesn't mean we won't be at other services, but we won't be hosting and we won't be taking all of those services. Thank you. Please stand for the blessing. The Lord be with you.
And with you.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and fill you with his peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, rest upon you and those whom you love and those who love you, this day and forevermore.
Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ. Amen.